Hello, welcome to the Legislative Report from Albany. I'm Senator Roxanne J. Persaud, representing the 19th Senatorial District. And here with me today is a student from the Canarsie section of the district. He's an intern here in Albany. He's a student here also, and a community activist. His name is Jibril Jallo. Jibril, welcome to our show today.
Thank you. It's a great honor to be here today, Senator.
So, tell me something about yourself. Tell me what is it you want people in the community to know about you, the dynamic person that you
are. The way my story goes, I'm Jibril Jallo. As you said, I'm a community activist. I'm a senior at Baruch College, majoring in economics. I was born in Brooklyn, and I'm happy to say I'm a proud lifetime resident of Canarsie. Growing up, I wouldn't say I had the easiest life, but thanks to the guidance of my parents, I was able to stay out of trouble, get good grades, and make it to college. My parents always told me that college was a must, so once I was accepted into Baruch and became a first-generation college student, I knew that's when the real work would begin. To be honest, I don't feel as though high school prepared me for college. Once I got there, it was very difficult for me to balance a full course load and work part-time to help support my family. I had to reinvent myself. I had to build upon the values that got me into college in the first place. So after countless nights in the library and speaking to upperclassmen for help and advice, I was able to finally acclimate into the college atmosphere. Sometime after that, I decided I wanted to push myself a little bit further, and I joined a couple organizations on campus, such as the Urban Male Leadership Academy, Sikh Society, the Black Student Union. And through these clubs, I was able to improve my communication skills, establish deep relationships, and expand on my leadership capabilities.
You know, it's interesting that you said you don't feel you were prepared for college when you left high school. Because one of my missions is to ensure that the kids who are attending our schools, when they get to the level, that they must have an equal opportunity at the table. So I want to make sure that they're well prepared. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting that you touched on that and that you use the library. The library is one of the places I'm always fighting for to ensure that they have resources. Because many of our kids in the community rely on the library as their resource.
Definitely.
You know, you're part of many organizations within college. What brought you to Albany?
What brought me to Albany? Well, it all started back throughout my college career. I had this class, anthropology, and one of our main assignments was to search the issues affecting your community, do some research, write a final report. To my finding, at first, I only believed gang violence and I would say high incarceration rate was the only issues affecting my community. But after doing deeper research, I realized we have a big housing crisis. I realized that racial profiling is at an all-time high. This was back in 2013 when Stop and Frisk was very prevalent. And once I realized that, I jumped into public service. I couldn't stand by.
When you say I jumped into public service, what did you do?
Well, first I reached out to one of my mentors, Charles Fall, who works in the mayor's office.
Okay.
At that time, he was the Muslim liaison. And I said, hey, I like the work you're doing. I want to get into the work of public service. May I intern for the mayor's office? So he got me the interview. I crushed the interview. And I started working in the mayor's office last summer. From then, it's just been I've just been on the way up. After that, I applied for Jamani Williams' office, who I was privileged to work there, and then one of my professors told me, hey, you have this experience, you have a lot of drive, a lot of passion, why not try to take it further, go to Albany? So I applied, and I'm here today with my state senator.
Well, thanks for being here again today. I know you're the assembly office that you're working with, that assembly member also covers part of our district, and you know, I hear good things about you. But I want to come back to what you do in the district, and so that our youth will understand that there is hope for them. Mm-hmm. There are things for them to do. What would you give, some advice you would give to them as to how to get into constructive things to do within the community?
Well, from a personal aspect, I would say find out what you're passionate about. If you're not passionate about the issues affecting your community, it's very hard to make a real change because there's a lot of opposition coming, being in the Senate, in the minority. I know you know there's a lot of opposition. You have to be passionate about what you're fighting for. And number two, I would say, start anywhere. There's so many, like when I met with you last week, I didn't realize how many resources, how many avenues I could take to make a change in my community. You talked about being on the precinct. You talked about going to community board meetings. There's so many resources. I did a small Google search on what could I do in Canarsie, and pages on pages of things that I could do. So I would just encourage the youth in my community to just start. Just find out issues that's affecting your community. Quick Google search, how can I help in housing, or how can I help in policing in my community? And I'm sure the age we live in today, it's so easy.
It's easy to find information. Definitely. You know, going back to you being in college and all of the organizations that you're part of, I was told that you're a child of immigrants. Yes. What is that experience like? What is it being, you know, a child of an, I am an immigrant also. And you know, the mindset is different.
Yes.
You know, your parents want you to do this, want you to do that. Tell us, how has that molded you? Being, you know, understanding the culture that your parents came from and the culture of New York City?
Well, it's incremental to the man you see before you today. My parents, they've had a big impact on my life. My dad, he's a taxi driver. My mom is a nurse practitioner. My mom taught me how to be caring, how to care for people. And my dad taught me the values of hard work. Without that strong support system from my family, without having those tangible role models of my mom and my dad, I don't believe I would have made it as far as I have. And that plays a big part in our community. New York is so diverse. The college I went to is so diverse. Brooke is one of the most diverse colleges in the nation. And coming from a different background and having such caring, loving parents, I know that you have to be able to understand other languages. I'm starting to learn Italian. And if you learn other languages and try to view other perspective, you have a more holistic view of the world. And I believe that's key to making change.
I have two nephews who speak Italian also. And now they're trying to give their parents trouble. They don't want to speak it. Oh, I don't want to speak the language. But it is important that you understand a different language. Mm-hmm. So you understand a different culture.
Yes.
And again, as an immigrant, and you know, you understand your culture, and then you look at what it is, how the culture is here in New York City.
Yes.
I want to get back to something else that you touched on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you went to the mayor's office.
Yes.
The mayor's office, I'm trying to get the connection with the issues that you were facing and the office that you interned in, the mayor's office. What was that connection?
Well, again, as I mentioned, one of my main mentors, Charles Fall,
right.
It's funny how I actually got into the mayor's office. He came to my local mosque, my local masjid, and I'm Muslim. He came to my local masjid and speaked about all the great things the mayor's office is doing. And this was right around the time I was doing that anthropology work. So seeing him right after he gave his speech, I went up to him, I tried to connect with him, say again, hey, how could I help in my community? I want to help. I like the work you're doing.
So did you, some of the things that you learned in his office, how did you bring it back to the community?
How did I bring it back?
Yeah.
Well,
and you know, talking with your peers when you're, you know, on, you know, when they're talking about issues that are occurring in a community, how do you bring it back and say, well, this is what I learned, this is what we need to do? How did you do that?
Well, again, to the point of it's a perfect time to get involved. If you have to wait, if you think, a lot of times when I speak to my peers, they say, oh, Jabril, how are you going to change the world? It's too much out there. It's too much to do. My thought is, again, just start.
One step at a time.
Exactly, Senator. Just start. Just, if it's one march, one person feel as though, oh, I'm just one guy. No. It takes one person, MLK, Malcolm X. It just takes one person to start a revolution. Just find out what you're passionate about and just start. A lot of the people, a lot of my friends, they feel the problems intimidate them. Wow, racial profiling, mass incarceration. How am I going to take care of it? No, don't look at it from a big perspective. Start on your street. Speak to somebody at a bus stop. Say, hey, calm down. Actually, when I was part of the Black Student Union, one of the first things that I said we have to do is have a Know Your Rights forum. A forum where I brought in some of my friends from CUNY Law and said, hey, these small infractions are leading to life and death situation. What could we do? So we had a Know Your Rights workshop and focus on de-escalation techniques. It was a small step, but I just hope from that workshop, learning how to deal with law officers, I would maybe be able to save a life by
We'll work with you, bringing you into the community, because some of the youth initiatives that we have in our pipeline deals with that. Mm-hmm. Because too often youth, they don't understand how to deal with authoritative figures that, definitely, you know, it doesn't matter whether it's a police officer or anyone else. They just don't understand how to deal with them. And so, you know, you've taken that initiative to bring that mm-hmm. to your peers. It's a great step. And we can continue to work on things of that nature.
Thank you. I'll be happy to. I'll be happy.
Well, thank you. You know, we also have here, we were looking to make sure our youth, because we're focusing on youth here, understand the important role they play in the success of a community. Can you just speak to them as if you were speaking to a group of your peers, say, telling them so that they can understand what it means to be part of your community and that what you do impacts your community?
Well, I would say, again, one person is all it takes to make a difference. When you see a familiar face going to a march, when you see a familiar face picking up garbage off the street, when you see a familiar face, whether it be an officer or a taxi driver in your community, it helps, it starts a chain effect. When one person starts to work and take a stake in their community, it builds on itself tenfold. When an organization comes from the outside, they can do great work, mm-hmm. but I believe...
Then they leave.
It's up to us in the community to take care of ourselves, to look out for each other. So I encourage the youth to speak with each other. We don't have to wait for somebody to come in and swoop in and save us. That's not to say that we don't need help, mm-hmm. but I'm saying we could also help ourselves. Let's not wait. So that's my message to the youth. We could have just as much impact on ourselves as...
I have one other question for you, pertaining to the youth again. Mm-hmm. We see a spike in violence, particularly gun violence.
Yes.
What would you say to that?
That's one. That's a very touchy topic for me. I believe in 2012, mm-hmm. one of my friends lost their life to gun violence.
Oh, sorry to hear that.
And that's just—it's just sad that there are so many ways to
de-escalate a situation.
There's mm-hmm. so many solutions. It doesn't have to come to violence. And I'll just implore the government to, because it's not only gun violence from us, it's gun violence from the other side as well. Have we seen lately in the Mike Brown case. So I would implore the government to help build trust within the community. Sometimes our youth, unfortunately, they don't feel they're supported. Sadly, if you ask somebody in my community that looks like me, what do you think of government? The first thing that comes to their mind is either policing or incarceration. The government provides so much for us. They provide health care, as you said, resources to read, the library. They provide the public education system, summer jobs, which are so important to curb gun violence. Mm-hmm. So I would implore the government to show the youth that, hey, government does so much for us. Try to come get involved and help us solve these issues, because there's a mind out there that if we don't support him, he or she may have the solutions to the problems we're dealing with today.
That is so true. Our youth must understand that. They must understand it's a shared responsibility. You know, we have to get an end to the violence that's plaguing our community, and it starts with us.
Yes.
One last thing I want to ask you.
Yes.
Somebody you want to say to as your role model, who would you say that person?
Who's?
Yeah.
If I had to choose one, which is very hard, mm-hmm. I'm sorry, Mom, but I have to choose my dad. My dad is just something else. Coming here, I can only imagine what he went through. Coming here 20-something odd years ago, working from the bottom up. He told me nights where he didn't even know where he was going to sleep, how much odd jobs he had to work. And having my dad there is the number one factor why I am here today working to help my community.
Well, thank you very much for being here today, Jibril. This has been Roxanne J. Persaud, Senator for representing the 19th Senatorial District. And with me was Jibril, a community activist, a student from the Canarsie end of the community. He told us in all of the issues that he thinks is plaguing our community and what we should do collectively as a community to curb the violence. Again, thank you for watching us today, and we look forward to seeing you again.